comprehend it. Everything in connection with these respective phases of redemption, that is particularly true of the last. And I am not attempting for a moment to cover all the ground of the second coming or the coming again of the Lord in this little time. Again, we ask the question and focus our attention upon it. Why the coming again of the Lord Jesus? Coming of the Lord is most commonly thought of as an event, something that is going to happen at a given time, an item in a program. It is just something that will take place. Well, of course, that is quite true. But it is quite important that we should know why it should take place. Why he will come again. See, God could effect all the things associated with his coming without his son. I mean, if it's a matter of taking Christians to heaven, he could do that without Christ coming to fetch it. And there are many other things like that that God could do directly and quite independently. But the scriptures show us that they are all bound up with and centered in the personal coming of Christ. And it is that fact which gives point to the question, why should it be like that? Why should it be a matter of Christ coming back again? Well, very briefly, let us try to answer that. And really, the answer is found in all that we have been saying in these days. The realization that the coming again of the Lord is just his own confirmation of all that. He said as he went from them, I am with you unto the consummation of the age. In the coming up of the age, well, that's the meaning of the word, with the coming up of the age, then what is it in the age that will be summed up at the end? It will be all that we have been saying about him in these days. Let us very hurriedly pass our eye over it in order to see the summation in his coming. And the first and the final coming are clearly united in purpose and realization. The first phase of redemption which we were occupied was the incarnation of God's Son. His coming in man form into this world. And we indicated that there were three purposes in the incarnation. One, the redemption of man by man. By man, sin came. By man, sin must go. By man came the consequences of sin. By man, those consequences must be destroyed and put away. It is the man aspect of things you see in the incarnation, the very point of his becoming man. The redemption of man. The reconstituting of man to make him the kind of man that God intended him to be, that which he has so grievously ceased to be. And the perfecting of man for glory. Those were the three things bound up with his coming in the first instance in man's form. Just hold that here for a minute. The second phase was his earthly life. We summed up the earthly life by saying that being here from infancy, from birth, to full mature manhood, through every trial and testing, fiery ordeal, right up to the last moment in the cross, when the fires were seven times heated, he presented a body to God without a mark of sin, of failure, or breakdown. A body has God prepared me, he said. And he presented that death to God, having passed through every possible kind of trial. He presented it without any taint, without any loss of spiritual character. He presented it back to God, a whole burnt offering, acceptable, well pleasing to God. He represented the man that God is after, living a life absolutely triumphant from beginning to end over all that which humanity has to meet, and so became the example man according to God's heart, the man that God is after and is going to have. Deeply. There was one thing that I had no time to mention in that connection. I'd like just to put it in here without dwelling upon it. There was something of very great meaning in the Son of God, that Son of Man, putting his feet upon this earth. You know this, that 24th Psalm, which we quoted the other day, it begins with, "The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof." That's the first stanza. Second stanza, "Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord?" Even as clean hands from a pure heart, not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Third stanza, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, the everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall enter in." You see the movement? He put his feet on the earth. The earth is the Lord. Stood on this earth. And he has lived his life without defiled hands or heart. He is the one who, and who alone, is fit, or the only type fit, to ascend into the hill of the Lord. And because he has come here and so lived and so triumphed, the everlasting door of the sun opened. He can enter in. Now the point is this: the earth is the Lord. He has put his feet down on this earth, and he has said, this earth belongs to this kind of man, and heaven will attest it. That's the 24th Psalm. And that is why he said to his disciples, when he had lived the life, and gained the victory, and risen triumphant, go into all the world. You can put your feet down on the earth and claim it. It's my inheritance by right of creation, by right of redemption. You go and put your feet on it. It belongs to me. That's all in the course of redemption. The cross was making effective that redemption, the purpose of the incarnation, making effective that redemption of the earth on which he put his feet and lived his triumphant life. He took it out of the hands of the prince of this world by his cross. He took the kingdom for himself. Now that he is the prince of this world, talk about. Now is the prince of this world, talk about. In the resurrection, he's in possession of that. He is establishing for 40 days the great fact that he's alive. He's alive, he became dead, he's alive forevermore. He has the keys of death and of Hades. And he's establishing that in the very being of the nucleus of his church for all time. And then he goes to glory in their presence, and the whole thing, the incarnation with its meaning, the life with its glorious triumph, the cross with its wonderful destruction of the work of the devil, the whole thing is taken and put beyond the reach of anything here, men or devil, to touch it, to wash it. It's put in heaven. Remember what the apostle says to us about heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, nor thief break through, nor steal. Your life is hid with Christ in God. It's up there. Nothing here can interfere with that. Well, there's the attention. The Spirit came to bring all that back, potentially, out of heaven, to take up the work of making good in believers of this dispensation. And the church was born as the vessel, the one new man. I'm always afraid of using language like this, because it's just here, you see, that people get hold of things when you speak about the church being Christ incarnate again. But the Spirit came to indwell the church, to make the church as the body of Christ, his counterpart, for expressing all the work that he himself had done and taken to glory. Church was born, we dwelt on that this afternoon. Lord, he's coming again. What for? To finish it all. To complete all that he came to do in the first place, in every realm. Complete the redemption of man. The 8th chapter of the letter to the Romans deals with this consummation of redemption in two respects. The manifestation of the sons of God. They have been secret, they have been hidden, and they are only the Father, only the Son knows who are His. They're going to be manifested. That is the confirmation of redemption, bringing of them out and manifesting them, making them know, displaying them in glory. I think it's very wonderful, you know, that word of the Apostle Paul to the Thessalonians on this very point.
Please turn the tape over now and continue listening at this point on track 2. Do not fast wind the recorder in either direction.
Corruption and therefore from death.
not making them into deities, but conferring through grief upon them all the values of his own fire. Physical redemption. You see, for I becoming to make good all that he came for and all that he has done. But that are all. Although that statement comprehends it all, we haven't broken it up into all its parts. We have said that in the cross, while he was there dealing with the whole sin question, and he dealt with it fully and finally in himself, he was more than that, dealing with the whole Satan question. We have sought to stress this, emphasize this in this conference, that the real battle of the cross was in that cosmic realm of principalities and powers. That's where the real battle went on. And it was a terrific battle. A terrific battle. With every evil, sinister, dark thing of the kingdom of Satan. But it was there that the full time of the Lord Jesus was won. His coming again is to make that absolute, final, and good so far as the church is concerned. We are in the battle. And it is very true. The more you stand on the ground of Calvary, the more you stand on the ground of the cross, the more fierce the battle becomes. Satan hates that cross. Hates that cross. You really, really spiritually stand on the ground of the meaning of the cross, and you're in for a battle. You do anything to move you off that ground. He's done that. He just finished that whole conflict for the church as he did it in himself, or in the church as he did it for the church. When he comes, that will finish or consummate the reign of Satan, the kingdom of darkness. That's why he is coming. Why the coming? Well, all that. Well, I could say it, but it means many more things, but I'm not going to. But I want to bring it all to this point again. You see, it is the coming of the Son of Man. That's how he put it. The coming of the Son of Man. I'm sorry they changed those words to let him. You see him not? Yeah. I wouldn't have had it if I'd known. If I'd been alive to it, we'd have had the other version. Oh, glorious morning, when the Son of Man shall come. That's how he put it. That's how the scriptures put it. Not the Son of God. It's true it's the Son of God. But you understand? There's a very real point here. It was man for man as man all the way through, and it will be death at the end. The incarnation has no significance if it is not man for man. Therefore, life has no meaning if it is not man for man. The cross has no meaning if it is not man for man. The same of the resurrection, the same of the ascension and enthronement, it is a man in the glory we see. Jesus, that with human title, crowned with glory and honor. It's man for man in heaven. Church is the birth of the one new man by the Holy Spirit sent down from heaven. The coming again is man for man. It's man constantly making this whole thing in relation to man, and man entering into his inheritance in Christ. Oh, all this marvelous thing for man, for you, for me. He's coming as the Son of Man. Men's men with a man bound after their title. It's his relationship to the human race. And all his work for the human race. And his representation in heaven of the human race. Present appeal for men on the basis of all that. All that caricature of it all has come about. Christmas. Think of it. Think of it in the light of what we have said about the incarnation. The redemption, the reconstituting, the perfecting and the glorifying of man. Where does that come in the common Christmas of our time? Liberal has just switched the whole thing over and made it a contradiction of its real meaning. We draw out that other man, the old man, by this very meaning, to glut himself, his own gratification. And so in everything else, thing has been given a wrong turn. The coming of the Lord Jesus, it will all be put right. But in the meantime, his appeal to us, to man, his appeal to us is on the ground of this. He came for our redemption. He came to make us different, to reconstitute us. He came to perfect us after his own image. He came to glorify us. He's shown in his own life here that it can be done. It's been done in a man. It can be done. He's done it. He came, for he said, the Son of Man, the Son of God is manifested to destroy the works of the devil, came to destroy the works of the devil. He's died in his cross. He's appealing to us on a very, very large ground. This is all redemption. Redemption is a tremendous thing. All the way round, like this, we have a great redemption. Because we have a great Redeemer. Tonight we are thinking of the time when he's coming to just put the last big touches to it all. Give the final touch to all this wonderful redemption. Man of the earth, the whole creation, he shall come to be glorified in his thing. Now, dear friends, we never embark upon prophecies over this matter, indulge in date fixing or anything like that. But I think I speak for more myself when I say there's something in the air that seems to say he's coming up in here. That it's not far off. The creation grows more than ever. And we grow more than ever. Travails in this creation becoming almost unbearable. This earth needs redeeming. God only knows what will happen to it if it isn't redeemed, this creation. All this may be the portent, but whatever that may be, there's something in the spirit of the true child of God which says, he's coming he is drawing nigh. It's the only hope. It is the only hope. There is no hope in any other direction. Everybody surely recognizes that. Saved and unsaved. Unless God Almighty intervenes, there's no hope. Ah, but he's going to intervene in his time. And there is the hope. And so the apostle speaks of the blessed hope. The blessed hope of the coming of the Lord. The Lord fill us with new joy in the very contemplation of his near coming to complete all that which he has begun.